Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Stéphanie Jolicoeur, and I will be your host for this afternoon's closing panel, in which we will talk about a very important subject, which is online radicalization, of course. A little bit about me to start off. I have a degree in physics at the l'Université Laval, pardon, in the Quebec City. But then after that, I went to study acting in an acting school, and I graduated from the Conservatoire d'art dramatique de Québec. And since 2016, or around that, I've been a science communicator. I am involved in various projects that take various shapes, with could be art science, scientific theater, poetry, scientific educating concerts with music. I do some research for science TV shows. You can hear me on Moteur de Recherche answering physics questions. Not always easy. I am always very involved in the science education with kids and teenagers. So the shape of my projects may vary, but something is always constant, is that I always have to provide to my public the most accurate science and in general information that I can find. And sometimes we have for that to fight misinformation. So here I am today to talk with you about a very serious subject, because online information highway is very loud, it's crowded. It can sometimes be dangerous. Misinformation spreads, unfortunately, rapidly, more rapidly and easily than information itself. And it can spark radical reactions from individuals and groups of individuals, of course. So today, I am joined by a panel of experts, of leading experts in media, misinformation, and science communication. And we will have a discussion about online radicalization. What is it? How it can occur? What are the signs? Are there some demographics that can be more susceptible to it? What can we do on our own platforms and channels? And we will also talk about how you, as science communicators, can manage your own health and well-being while still speaking out on tricky topics. We will also leave you with some tips and tricks for spreading the best available and most accurate science to your publics through your own channels. I just wanted to tell you, there will be some panelists will speak in French. So if need be, you can access the translation with the QR code. I'm gonna let you a few seconds to do that if need be. So please join me in welcoming our incredible group of panelists. First up is Timothy Caulfield. Well, yes. So Timothy is a Canada Research Chair in Health Law and Policy, a professor in the Faculty of Law and the School of Public Health, and Research Director of the Health Law Institute at the University of Alberta. His interdisciplinary research on topics like stem cells, genetics, research ethics, the public representations of science, and public health policy has allowed him to publish over 350 academic articles. He has won writing, academics, and science communication awards, and he is a fellow of the Royal Society of Canada and the Canadian Academy of Health Sciences. He is the author of two national bestsellers, The Cure for Everything, Untangling the Twisted Messages About Health, Fitness, and Happiness, and the famous one, Is Gwyneth Paltrow Wrong About Everything When Celebrity Culture and Science Clash? His most recent book is Relax, Damn It, A User's Guide to the Age of Anxiety. Speaking of, and Timothy is the co-founder of ScienceUpFirst and the host and co-producer of the award-winning documentary TV show A User's Guide to Cheating Death, which has been shown in over 60 countries, including North America, Netflix. Welcome, Timothy. We are welcoming Jonathan Montpetit. Jonathan is a senior investigative reporter at CBC Radio Canada, where he covers social movements and democracy. Jonathan holds advanced degrees in political science from McGill University and the London School of Economics, and he has spent the 2021-2022 academic year as a journalism fellow at Massey College. Bonjour, Jonathan. Merci d'être avec nous. Dr. Krishana Sankar has received her PhD from the Faculty of Medicine at the University of Toronto. She has well over 10 years of experience in scientific research and is a sought-after speaker and science communicator whose doctoral research discusses the importance of STEM education, science communication, and, of course, misinformation. Dr. Sankar is the science advisor and community partnership lead for ScienceUpFirst, and in her role, she works to remove barriers to accessing accurate and relevant information to fight misinformation among these groups. Merci, Dr. Sankar. Professor Marie-Ève Carignan is an associate professor in the Department of Communication at the University de Sherbrooke and holds a PhD in communication from the Université de Montréal, as well as a PhD in information and communication from the Institut d'études politiques d'Aix-en-Provence. She is a co-holder of the UNESCO Chair in Prevention of Radicalization and Violent Extremism. Professor Carignan's research focuses mainly on media content analysis, the impact of media on society, risk and crisis communication, and communication strategies. She has obtained numerous research grants to study the communication strategies of public health actors, as well as the impact of misinformation, the rise of conspiracy thinking, and the effectiveness of prevention tools in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. She is the co-author of the book Mon frère est complotiste, Comment rétablir le lien et le dialogue social. Merci, Marie-Ève, d'être avec nous aujourd'hui. So, the first part of our discussion will be focusing on the nature of online radicalization. So, Timothy, if you may start, I would like to ask you, what exactly is online radicalization and why is it such a big problem?
Very much for the opportunity to be here today. And I think this really is an incredibly important conversation and one that's becoming more and more important. And I'm actually curious how my colleagues are going to define radicalization, because I think it's fair to say there isn't really a clear definition of what is meant by radicalization. You hear it a lot in the popular press. You hear it in the academic literature. But I think everyone agrees it means the adoption of extreme views that in general reside on the fringes. And in addition to that, you often talk about the element of some kind of action, right? That you're becoming part of a community and that community involves some kind of action that obviously is less than constructive. Personally, I don't know if you guys agree with this, I think we can expand that latter part of the equation to include action online, becoming an active voice online. Because I think that's one of the reasons why the conversation we're having today is so important, because we're seeing that element more and more. This is increasingly about social media. The other reason, of course, why this is such an important conversation is the role that social media and online communities are having in the building of these communities. You know, one of the great things about social media is the community element of it, right? That's the good part of it, but it can also be one of the very detrimental parts of the power of social media. So research is consistently telling us that it's these social media communities, the sense of community that is online that is helping to foster these extreme views, and of course, often it's playing to individuals that might be vulnerable for that kind of exploitation. So I think that's a very important element. And the other thing that we have more and more research on is the nature of social media, the incentives baked in to social media favor extreme views. And so you create these echo chambers. And again, we have more and more research to talk about. Some of the research has come out literally in the last couple of weeks that highlights the degree to which this is the case. That social media, the incentives built into it, both for the platforms, but also for the users, highlight the extreme views and invite the creation of these communities. And once you're in those communities, those echo chambers, veracity becomes less important than the community and the goals of the community. And there was a study that came out literally 2 weeks ago that highlighted exactly that. Hmm. So a terrible response to a very important question. Not a clear definition about radicalization, and I think that's interesting because I think it's a moving target. But it absolutely has to do with the extremism that we're, and the polarization that we're seeing on social media.
And besides the sense of community for vulnerable people, are we aware of other reasons that could bring people to radicalization? Jonathan?
I mean, if the question is, why is it that people radicalize online? So I'll leave part of that question to maybe Marie-Ève could, you know, in terms of the psychological disposition of people who are predisposed to being radicalized online, certain socioeconomic characteristics. But to kind of pick up on what Timothy was talking about, I think, like, what do you need to be radicalized? You need information. Particularly, you need counter-information, right? You need to be able to build a worldview that is at odds or alternative to what the consensus is. And you need community. You need other people to believe what you believe. You need other people to push you further. And the internet is basically information plus community. And I think that's one of the reasons why the internet is a place where radicalization can happen so easily. And you throw in algorithms, you throw in the kind of architecture of social media platforms, which really does encourage, we've seen it, it does encourage polarization, does encourage radicalization. And I think, you know, polarization, radicalization, they go together, right? Because when you kind of build an alternative worldview and you cease being able to speak to people who disagree with you, who have access to perhaps mm-hmm. more easily, more trustworthy information, the rabbit holes is something we talk about it, you know, but it's like a self-perpetuating cycle. So I think that's one of the reasons that people do radicalize online. And I just also, we should just keep in mind, certainly in a lot of the work that I do, radicalization doesn't only happen online. Like it exists in a kind of dialectic with real world in IRL activities. And you know, a lot of the white supremacist groups that I monitor as part of my job, you know, there's a lot of their activity. They couldn't exist without Telegram, and they couldn't exist without social media, but there's always a push to do things in person. Show us you really exist. Show us you're really hardcore. And it is those in-person events that help, I think, consolidate the seeds of community that are implanted online. And when you do something in person with a bunch of other people, you share an experience. That's I think, key to consolidating the identities that I think are necessary for radicalization to become a social problem.
And are we aware of any data that could tell us if there are certain demographics that could be more vulnerable, susceptible to fall in the rabbit hole of misinformation and then radicalization?
It's addressed to me, I think. Allow me, I will speak in French because I could be more specific, but if you have some question in English, I can switch, no problem. But yeah, like Timothy said, it's hard to define what is radicalization. And I think our one of our research showed that when we, I said that I will speak in French and now I'm in English. One of our research showed that we studied 1 year of press coverage of radicalization in Quebec, and what we find it's in 1 year, no newspaper defined what is radicalization. Only one paper defined it, and it was written by a university professor in Le Devoir. So it was a university text, if you want. So the definition isn't clear, and the people doesn't know what we mean by radicalization. And my colleague from University of Montreal, led by Solange Lefebvre, demonstrate that people doesn't really understand what it radicalization. So I agree with him. I think it's important to say because we heard a lot about radicalization, but in fact people doesn't really understand what is it. And I think
cannot discuss it. Yeah, smart
so
manner. If we don't.
Radicalization, yeah, I think brings people to polarize themselves, isolate themselves, and sometimes it can lead to violent extremism. So yeah, it's important. And when we look at social demographic characteristic, what we saw, it's là, je vais switcher en français pour être plus nuancé. Il y a pas vraiment de caractéristiques spécifiques parce que bon, tout le monde peut être vulnérable à un moment ou un autre de leur vie à adhérer finalement à des comportements radicaux ou à se radicaliser dans leurs actions. Puis c'est ce qu'on voit notamment quand on regarde nos données sur l'adhésion au complotisme, l'adhésion parce que le complotisme souvent est très proche d'idées radicales. On voit par exemple dans les discours d'extrémistes blancs ou de groupes suprémacistes, il y a toujours aussi beaucoup d'idées conspirationnistes finalement qui se mélangent. Et ce qu'on va voir, c'est que finalement, bon, dans nos données notamment chez les conspirationnistes les plus radicaux, donc ceux qui sont des adhérents très convaincus au conspirationnisme, au Canada, là, on parle environ de 8% de Canadiens. Peut-être, mais souvent on voit plus d'hommes qui vont être radicaux, surtout qui vont être d'accord avec les comportements violents, donc avec l'idée qu'on doit avoir recours à la violence, la violence peut être légitime. Donc le recours à la violence peut être légitime pour faire entendre un point de vue, défendre une opinion qui est souvent extrême parce qu'ils sont radicalisés. Donc ces gens-là vont souvent être plus des hommes, mais ce qu'on voit, c'est que la porte d'entrée pour les idées radicales bien, varie. Il y a plus de femmes qui souvent vont entrer dans le complotisme ou les idées radicales par la médecine alternative, les discours anti-vax. Mais il y a des gens qui adhèrent de tous âges. Nos données montrent 18-55 ans, c'est les gens qui adhèrent le plus au discours alternatif. Donc, on ne peut pas avoir un portrait précis au niveau socio-démographique. Souvent, c'est aussi des vulnérabilités. Donc, ce qu'on voit, c'est que des gens qui vont se radicaliser en ligne, soit c'est des gens qui ont peut-être moins un cercle de soutien autour d'eux, donc des amis, de la famille qui les soutiennent, ils se sentent seuls. Puis justement, d'arriver dans des cercles en ligne où il y a des chambres d'écho, où on peut sentir que des gens partagent notre point de vue puis se redonner une espèce de pouvoir ou de sentiment de pouvoir puis d'adhésion sociale. Mais ça, c'est un élément qui va faire en sorte que des gens vont adhérer. Il y a aussi des moments où les gens vivent des dépressions, de l'anxiété, donc des vulnérabilités psychologiques qui font qu'on est plus sensible d'adhérer à un discours qui nous donne une impression de pouvoir, une impression de changer les choses ou qui vient nous conforter dans un moment d'instabilité, à un moment précis de nos vies. Donc, souvent, les facteurs psychologiques, anxiété, dépression, isolement, sont plus importants dans l'adhésion que les données sociodémographiques comme femme, âge, niveau d'éducation. So, yeah, I think the people are really vulnerable when they are anxious, depressed, isolated. So, that's the main factor.
And it can happen to anybody. Yeah. But we can just do correct me if I'm wrong. So it's hard to say because, right, like you said, it can happen to anybody, loneliness, absence of family and friends to support you. But in some social and political movements, hateful movements, hate groups, there is tendencies. Yeah. And these movements can often be associated with misinformation. Right.
For example, right-wing movements or movement that tends to adopt more violent action, then you see more male in general than female in that kind of movement. Yeah.
And is there any signs that we can recognize in people that could tell us that radicalization is in process?
Oui, ce qu'on peut voir notamment, c'est des gens qui vont commencer à avoir des discours de plus en plus radicaux, justement, donc des moins nuancés, moins ouverts à la critique, moins ouverts finalement à ce qu'on vienne les contredire dans leurs croyances. On va voir aussi tranquillement, les gens qui sont en train de se radicaliser vont souvent s'isoler, justement, donc s'éloigner des gens qui ne partagent pas leurs croyances, et donc ils vont parfois tester leurs croyances auprès de leur cercle, de leur famille, de leur entourage. Et s'ils voient que les gens n'adhèrent pas, bien, ils vont tranquillement s'éloigner. Donc, voir des gens qui vont s'isoler, qui vont avoir des discours beaucoup plus extrêmes, moins nuancées, puis qui ne vont pas accepter nécessairement de parler à des gens qui ne partagent pas leurs croyances, ben, ça peut être des premiers signes là, de radicalisation. Puis moi, ce qui me conforte beaucoup, entre autres, il y a deux semaines, on a fait une conférence sur justement la réaction à nos rapports puis à nos livres sur le complotisme. Et il y avait Louis-Philippe Audet-Gosselin du Centre de prévention de la radicalisation dans la violence de Montréal. Il disait que depuis que le livre est sorti, beaucoup plus de gens appellent pour... participer à des groupes de discussion, de soutien aux proches de gens qui se radicalisent parce qu'ils ne savent pas toujours que ces centres-là, ces ressources-là existent puis peuvent leur donner les outils pour justement prévenir que les gens se radicalisent davantage puis donc les rattraper avant finalement qu'ils passent là, un niveau de radicalisation plus important. Donc, il y a des ressources comme le CPRMV qui existent pour les proches des gens radicalisés.
I'm curious, Dr. Sankar, in your work, have you come to the same conclusions?
So in our work at ScienceUpFirst in terms of misinformation, so we do know that false information can lead to shaping a lot of hateful beliefs and behaviors. So it is important to understand essentially, you know, the types of personalities that would become susceptible to misinformation. You know, in my work, some of the things that we've come across, and I know this has also been seen in the literature, and I think it was just mentioned, anybody can be vulnerable to misinformation. But the thing is, those who tend to be even more susceptible to it, they tend to be those people who are constantly online. So they're online a lot in a lot of the always on the online platforms. We are actually tending to see lots of younger people being more susceptible to a lot of misinformation. I think Mariav mentioned too, a lot of white males too are being susceptible and also radicalized. People who seem to have more trust in family and friends versus experts. And they have more conservative ideologies as well as lower education levels. So, you know, these are some of the things that we've come to notice and recognize. And I think Mariav also mentioned this, and probably in French. But a lot of it is, you know, when there's a lot of isolation and people are looking to have, you know, they want to be part of a group. They want to feel connected to other people. And so with that, you know, unfortunately, with all the misinformation we're seeing on social media channels, if people are falling within those isolated groups, unfortunately, they may become more radicalized in those areas.
It's disconcerting sometimes because it's like I've seen in the pandemic, well, we were speaking about spending more time online, which was the case of everybody during the pandemic, sadly. Like even people that have a science academic background formation, right? Like we learned the scientific method and it doesn't save us apparently, because I've seen like one of my physics teachers in university that had fallen in this trap. It was terrible to see. You know, I was thinking, well, he's a physics professor and he knows the scientific method and it's supposed to save us from that, but it doesn't, or?
I could comment on that because you're right. And I think it goes very much to the power of these communities. You know, I've become very interested in the role of ideology in this realm, and you'll have to be very careful because misinformation happens across, right, the ideological continuum, and that's, I think, really important to emphasize. But in this cultural moment, as you two probably know better than I do, we are largely talking about right-wing conspiracies. Study after study after study has shown that right now, in this cultural moment, you know, that's where a lot of the noise resides. And so people may be attracted to some sort of ideological position, and that draws them to the community. So maybe it's your physics professor, you know, they become part of that community, and then whatever position is associated with that position, they adopt too. And there have been studies that have shown this, you know, one conspiracy equals all conspiracies, right? And one of my favorite examples of it that I use frequently, and I think maybe you've heard this one, Krishana, is the work by Frank Graves that he's done. He's a survey expert, he works for ECOS, and by the way, this work has been replicated by groups in the United States too, but it's really dramatic. It shows that if you are pro-vaccine, you are more likely to be pro-Ukraine.
Oh,
if
yes,
you are anti-vax, you're more likely to be pro-Putin. Mm-hmm. And it's pro-Putin, right? And that sounds like, okay, you know, I can see that it's stark. It's stark. And I'll just give you one example. Frank's research found that 85% of vaccinated people, 85% of vaccinated people think that Russia is committing war crimes. Only 35% of unvaccinated people think that Russia is committing war crimes. That is stark. That's huge. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot going on in those numbers and in those stats, right? Because it highlights the degree to which it is about these communities. And once you in this community, you adopt this basket of beliefs that are part. It's part of these communities. It highlights the role of ideology, and it also highlights the role of state actors. By the way, that in this. But I think that. You know, it's really important to recognize how, I mean, which is, you know, that's a really radical position to hold, especially right now but despite that, these communities are pushing it. And I'm sure you guys have experienced this personally. I get a lot of hate mail every day. And my hate mailers, right after the invasion, switched from being anti-vaxxers to being pro-Putin. Like that day, it was incredible. It was incredible. It's the same community, same voices, same one big conspiracy is feeding everything.
Well, let's get the morals up. Okay, everything's okay. It's gonna be okay. But yes, well, we're gonna talk about politics because, like, in my mind, science is not political, right? A vaccine is a vaccine. A cell is a cell. It works a certain way. It doesn't have anything to do with politics. And somehow, both are associated right now. It's like a salad bowl, and you don't. Where's the line? Like, what's the relation between both? Can radicalization exist without politics, or is it like entirely political right now?
Maybe I can jump in, yes. But I think the link between all that is the distrust. Toutes les personnes qu'on a analysées, peu importe leur origine, donc qui adhèrent à des théories du complot, souvent ils vont rentrer par la porte de la défiance envers le gouvernement, envers la science, envers le politique, les médias. Et donc, c'était qui était assez particulier, notamment pendant la pandémie de COVID-19, on a vu des gens qui rentraient par leur méfiance. So sometimes they were coming from like anti-vax beliefs or... I don't know, alter science beliefs, and there was distrusting the government measure about COVID-19, the media, the politics, and then the right-wing extremism had the same discourse that they were trusting the government, the measure. So they all went together in that belief against politics, and now they're sharing a lot of conspiracy theory that at the beginning seems really disconnected because you have that people believe in alter science and anti-vax discourse, and now they're sharing stuff about Trump, about Putin, about QAnon, but they're linked in their distrust. And now, yeah, when you believe in some conspiracy theory, you start to believe in the whole world because you want to be part of that community, I think, yeah.
What could I have done faced with the comments of my ex-physics teacher, right, on Facebook? What can we do when we see our friends, our family, our ex-teachers fall into the rabbit hole? How do we react? Big question.
I mean, I can speak... I can speak in it in terms of, so again, through our like a lot of our community work. So for example, for the last several years during the pandemic, a lot of, you know, vaccine Q&A sessions, we would have ever so often people visit who of course are anti-vax, and for different reasons they would visit. Now, speaking to strangers versus speaking to family and friends can be very different. Sometimes we'll have more patience with a stranger because we won't see them again versus family and friends. But, you know, when it comes to strategies around chatting with loved ones, and especially in this extremely polarized environment. Some of the things that myself and my colleagues use, and I know Tim and I have been on several panels where we've spoken about this, and Tim has some views on this, but you know, I think it depends on the level at which they're at. If they're already radicalized or already extremist, honestly, I won't bother with it. It's probably, you know, it's like fighting a losing battle. But if they're in the mid, you know, in the middle ground and you're starting to see them go that way, honestly, one of the things that we have come to realize is a lot of them, and it was mentioned, if there's an ideology that they're holding on to, that they'll, you know, identify with, then one of the things they're looking for is a community that also believes, or that, you know, they believe this ideology in. They all believe in it. They want to belong. So I think honestly coming at them with conversations, being compassionate and caring, that caring language of, you know, come and be a part of this, you know, family and community, we're still together, is really important. We have to show that we can be compassionate, you know, when we're chatting, and not to be condescending or judgmental, because that's immediately one of the first ways to shut people down. I think also sharing that a lot of us have similar fears and concerns is really important, and finding that, you know, common ground, starting to talk about the very, you know, starting to talk about the accurate information and pointing out, you know, some of the things that they are seeing that's actually inaccurate, and sort of guiding their hand with it, showing them where it's inaccurate, showing them how the accuracies are, you know, correct, and sharing all that information with them. Now, having said all that, again, you know, there's only so much that we can do. We have these conversations. At the end of the day, you know, it's not in our best interest to do all of that despite our mental health. Mm-hmm. If our mental health is going to suffer, that's where I draw the line. But honestly, having those sort of compassionate conversations can sometimes start to open up, you know, that sort of conversation, in hoping to pull them back from them falling into the rabbit hole. At least that's a perspective we've been using.
If I could comment real quick, and I'm very curious about your comments on this, because you're, you know, you deal with the radical, right? And if is it a lost cause? But the other thing I think is really important is trying to get out of your echo chambers, right? And here's a really quick now test, you know, something that's happening right now. Many people in this room have probably heard about the Cochrane collaboration study that came out on masks. Did everyone hear about this? So Cochrane collaboration. Very respected organization, independent organization that does meta-analysis, systematic reviews, very a tight framework for making this happen. On January 30th, so just a couple days ago, they come out with a review, and this is going to be a horrible summary of what they said, but basically, masks don't work, is what they said. That's the headline. There was a headline in the Daily Mail right before I came here. Masks don't work. Cochrane collaboration. I always point to the Cochrane collaboration as a place to go to get good, reliable information. My gut reaction was, this has got to be wrong. Right? What's wrong with this review? I started reaching out to my epidemiology friends, my methods friends. Can you help me critique this? That's my bias. Like, I'm bringing my confirmation bias to this analysis, because I want a different result. And look, we don't have to critique it, because I think there are critiques to this study, and I do have critiques. That wasn't the point of bringing this up. It's more to highlight how powerful our confirmation biases can be, even when we want to do what we want to do right. So I think finding ways to get out of that, your echo chamber. There was this, that I'm sure you guys know about, the Fox News study. Do you know the study where they, they paid Fox News fans to watch CNN. Did you guys hear about this? And it was a real study, and the N was pretty big. And there was over 300 people. They paid them quite well. They had to watch Fox News the Fox News fans had to watch CNN for 7 hours a week. And you can imagine, everyone involved in this knows what's going on. Totally cynical study, right? I know what you want to do. You want me to watch Don Lemon. It's not going to work. It did work. It worked on every metric. And that's a good news story, right? Just being exposed to that different perspective. Now, yes, when they went back to Fox News, they went back to their position. But it is an example of the power of seeing these other perspectives, and the kind of thing that we have to figure out ways we can we can make that happen at scale. But I'm curious about what you, you know, the white supremacist, you're right in the heart of it. Is it, what can we do?
Yeah, I don't know what you can do. I mean, certainly with some of these people, it's a lost cause. I think, to Krishana's point, I think like one of the things, when it's people in your social circle, it's hard, right? And as, and for, you know, because when I confront or have friends who are for anti-vax, who are like, oh, the media is lying about the vaccine. I'm like, what do you think I'm lying? Like, do you like, dude, I work at the CBC. Do you think I go in every day and like cook up lies? Like we're buddies. How could you think that about my, and so I take it, you know, take it very seriously. And so in a way this is sound crazy, but sometimes it's easier to speak to a white nationalist because, you know, I don't know you, you don't know me. And I'm just trying to understand where you're coming from. I'm just trying to understand what your worldview is and who you threaten. And my job as a journalist is both to seek out that information, but also present it in a context which, you know, reinforces, makes space for cultural minorities, visible minorities, you know, like not to give too much space to. So the challenge is, how do I understand without giving too much space to the radical views, and it's hard. It's, you know, it's hard, and you have to kind of silence that inner voice that is disgusted, because if your questions come from that inner voice, then that dialogue becomes impossible. And I don't get the information, and I can't share that information with the rest of society. So you have to kind of silence that and really dig deep into whatever sense of empathy you have, and really sort of like silence that inner voice and just allow your curiosity to kind of operate naively. And that, it's not always easy, and sometimes you go home feeling dirty, but that's kind of one of the things you have to do in order to kind of extract the information that that you need, because I think like one of the roles that journalists can play in relation to some of the work that you guys do, at least this was true. I don't know. It's becoming less and less easy to do this, but is to go and talk to people, you know, and to really like have long, unstructured conversations with extremists, and so I think being able to do that is kind of really important in order to kind of develop deeper understandings of how conspiracy theories work, how ideology is operative, what people actually believe out there, you know, and I think you like we have to be able to listen to the to a lot of these seedy sides of society in order to kind of understand what the threat is, what the danger that they're posing. Because you have to be able to recognize it, right? And mm-hmm. and as probably all of you guys know, when you do some of this research, it's like learning another language. You know, when somebody invokes the Great Barrington Declaration, like, I didn't know what that was, but you have to find out. When somebody evokes the Great Reset, you know, like there are kind of like whole series of words and phrases that you have to be able to kind of understand and able to kind of like decode what is happening in a lot of these online chat rooms and be able to kind of understand what the danger is to our democratic process.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you for your expertise and insights. I would have a million other questions, but like according to our schedule, we don't have time for questions from the audience, but we will make time for questions from the audience, at least a few. And I'm sure that our experts after 5 o'clock will still be here to maybe exchange with you. But are there people here who would like to ask some questions? I can see nothing with this. Okay. Yeah, I'm going to give you some time to think about it. Oh, yes, we. Oui.
Raymond Fournier, journaliste scientifique. Est-ce que vous pouvez faire un parallèle entre la désinformation et le mouvement d'il y a un an des truckers, des camionneurs qui ont envahi la colline parlementaire à Ottawa? Parce que c'était quand même un mouvement très populaire, ce qui est arrivé il y a un an. Puis on voit aujourd'hui que, bon, ils ont fêté la, un an après, puis il y était quelques personnes. Mais qu'est-ce qui a mu ces personnes-là? On sait que les camionneurs sont des gens qui aiment beaucoup travailler. Ils travaillent seuls dans leur camion. C'est leur univers. Et ils sont quand même très structurés à faire des choses par eux-mêmes. Est-ce que il y aurait des parallèles avec des gens qui sont hautement radicalisés?
Oui, if you allow me. Oui, c'est sûr qu'il y a un lien entre les deux. Puis en fait, c'est que le mouvement des camionneurs puis le convoi de la liberté, finalement, était construit de beaucoup de choses. Puis on a un peu mélangé toutes ces choses-là. So, yes, the link between the Liberty Convoy in Ottawa and disinformation. Mais en fait, c'est qu'il y avait des gens qui avaient des raisons légitimes d'être là. Donc, il y a des gens qui allaient justement pour défendre les droits des camionneurs à la frontière, de ne pas nécessairement avoir un passe vaccinal. Il y a des gens qui allaient pour questionner les mesures sanitaires avec parfois des questions légitimes. Tim parlait de l'efficience du masque. C'est des questions qui peuvent être légitimes. Un couvre-feu, est-ce que c'est efficace? Et parfois, on n'osait pas aller dans l'espace public pour poser ces questions-là. Il y avait aussi des minorités sociales plus affectées par ces mesures-là. Les itinérants, des gens en situation précaire qui ne peuvent pas nécessairement respecter les couvre-feux, qui se ramassent avec des contraventions ou autres. C'est des questions légitimes et qu'on entendait peu dans l'espace public parce qu'on voulait les taire pour que les gens adhèrent aux mesures. Puis je peux comprendre des fois qu'on n'a pas envie non plus de créer une frustration, un moment de crise où les gens doivent s'unir ensemble. Mais en même temps, ces gens-là sont rapidement fait parfois traiter de complotistes alors que ce n'était pas ça, c'était des questions légitimes. Mais à côté de ça, ce que ces gens-là ne sont pas rendus compte, puisque souvent décrédibiliser leur questionnement légitime, c'est que derrière le convoi de la liberté, derrière l'occupation d'Ottawa, il y avait des leaders qui ont organisé ça, qui, eux, étaient des complotistes ou avaient adopté des discours complotistes et télescopaient le mouvement. Donc, par exemple, ce qu'on a vu, c'est que parmi les organisateurs, il y avait des gens qui étaient dans des partis liés à l'extrême droite ou à l'idéologie d'extrême droite. Il y avait des gens là-dedans qui avaient déjà eu des discours tels que le grand reset ou le grand remplacement, à l'effet que, par exemple, on allait être remplacé par des minorités ethniques, qu'il fallait nous protéger. Donc, des discours vraiment très d'extrême droite. Des gens aussi qui avaient des positions proches des citoyens souverains ou libertariens qui voulaient faire tomber le gouvernement, puis qui demandait, par exemple, à la gouverneure générale de remplacer les élus par des citoyens. Donc, il y avait un agenda politique très clair et très lié aux théories conspirationnistes. C'est le problème, c'est que ces gens-là ont manifesté, parfois en ignorant qu'à côté d'eux, c'était des gens qui avaient aussi un agenda politique, idéologique et très proche des théories du complot. Et ça a parfois décrédibilisé certaines questions légitimes, mais on voyait clairement, puis même là-dedans, il y avait des gens qui avaient un lien avec un passé où il était lié à la police ou à la sécurité même de l'Assemblée nationale et qui maintenant aidait les organisateurs et qui était très proche de croyances conspirationnistes liées notamment au mouvement d'extrême droite.
And, you know, if I can just continue on from that, you know, so one of the dynamics I think that happened with the protests in Ottawa and across the country is, so, you know, protest and questioning is obviously an integral part of the democracy, but I think one of the things you saw happening is you had people who were in the social media bubble, questioning, being exposed to not great sources of information, felt like they were the black sheep of their family, felt like they were alone, and then they go to Ottawa, all of a sudden there are a whole bunch of other people who think exactly like them, feel like they're mistreated by the government. And one of the concerns from people who study radicalization and extremism is that so you have the hardcore people like the Marie was just talking about who are there and who are seeking to radicalize people.
Mm-hmm.
So you have an event, everyone has a shared experience at this event, shared animosity towards the government, and then you have, bad faith actors who are there explicitly with the intent to further radicalize, exploit people who are there, and what will be the knock-on effect. Like, I think we're still in the process of discovering, you know, the kind of more long-term effects of those protests.
Thank you, Jonathan and Marie-Ève. Are there any other questions in the audience? Yes.
Well, thank you very much for the intervention. Merci pour vos réflexions. I was wondering about one thing that you kind of pointed that, well, I personally do not believe that there's a brutal switch. It's like you go slightly from one conspiracy ID and then fall into something wider. And on the other side, it seems that at some point when it gets too wide, you kind of, there's a possibility of getting out of it. And my question was if there is any kind of, I don't know, visibility on what brings you from a slight point of, oh, I believe in this, and then I'm switching to conspiracy theory on a more general scale. And on the opposite, what makes you, if you are into conspiracy theory, to reach the limits of saying, oh, but that's one step too much for me, and maybe I should think on all that I believe to possibly start stepping out of it. Thank you very much.
I can comment on that a little bit, and I'm sure you have something to say also. So there actually has been some interesting research, and as my colleague knows, it's actually kind of hard to study this well, right, to get really robust data. So you get data that sort of is suggestive and correlated. So there actually has been interesting research that came out quite recently about COVID being this entry point to conspiracy theory. So you believing in a COVID conspiracy theory leads people to these, you know, to start adopting these other kind of as we've already said. Now there is an interesting ongoing conversation that we've actually talked about over coffee in another situation, and my colleague Stephen Lewandowski has talked about this also, whether the number of people that are hardcore conspiracy theorists are actually increasing. Or is it really the they're just, it stayed the same and they're just having an influence on the movable middle? I think they're increasing. I'm curious what you think, but regardless, we know that it's having a broader impact in society. But that question is important because it goes to what kind of individual becomes these hardcore believers, right? Which goes to your belief. Now, again, another study that came out just last month talked about how that tipping point where you get into it, and once you start adopting other conspiracy theories, you kind of fall down the hole. And again, hard to study this well. It's sort of this qualitative research, but I think it fits with the literature more broadly and kind of fits with, it sounds like, what your intuition is. Climbing out of it, my sense from the literature, and I'm curious what you have to say about this, is it's kind of pessimistic. As you described, there's certainly anecdotes, and you hear stories about it in the popular press, and there've been these stories about, oh, I'm out of it now, and there's some great documentaries about people who were involved in January 6th conspiracy that climbed out of it. But in general, that's rare when you're a hardcore conspiracy theorist. So my sense from the literature is, we don't have a lot of data on what pulls those people out, what the trigger is to inform us, okay, can we do this at scale, right? Unfortunately. So we know more, I think, about people falling in and less about people climbing out. Do you think that's fair?
No, I 100% agree. And what we see right now online with that conspiracy leaders, for example, is that they switch from a conspiracy theory to another with the actuality opportunity, I would say. For example, they were against COVID-19 pandemics and public health measure, but now they are talking about climate change, about money and security, about Ukraine. So
World Health Organization.
They want to reach audience and go became popular. So yeah, they switch and the audience follow them. So yeah, I think I totally agree with you, team. And it's difficult to see what can bring sometimes people to jump out. In our book, we have an example from a guy we are working with, which is called Vincent Le Cavalier. He's now known at the Debunker des Étoiles in France. I was talking about this example at lunch, I think, with some colleagues. But It's a great example because he said he jumped in conspiracy theory by curiosity because he was interested in, oh, maybe the pyramid wasn't built like we know, and some curiosity, and it escalated. At the end, he was believing all the conspiracy theory against les théories sur les Juifs, par exemple, les théories du grand remplacement et tout ça. Et c'est quand il a été exposé à des théories sur l'astronomie que là, vraiment, il a décroché parce que... Ah, je pensais ce matin, j'en parlais un petit peu au panel, je me fais écho moi-même, mais vraiment, c'est des théories qui l'ont confronté parce que ça venait confronter ses croyances propres. Donc, je pense que c'est quand ça va vraiment à l'extrême de ce qu'on croit, de ce à quoi on adhère, que peut-être on peut décrocher, mais c'est vrai que c'est difficile parce que, comme tu me dis, non, il n'y a pas vraiment d'études qui démontrent, puis c'est tellement individuel qu'on ne peut pas faire des tendances générales selon le vécu d'un ou l'autre. Des fois, c'est plus un moment psychologique. Des gens, on trouve ça tellement lourd d'être dans ces cercles-là, puis d'adhérer, de toujours être un peu isolé, en retrait de leur famille, de leurs amis, que là, ils vont essayer de se rapprocher de leurs gens, puis décrocher. Mais ce qu'on voit souvent, c'est qu'en plus, ils vont prendre des bouts des théories qui viennent conforter leur discours puis leurs croyances. Donc, ils vont toujours s'accrocher d'une théorie à l'autre, à des éléments, puis faire du pick and choose pour venir se conforter. Donc, c'est difficile. Ouais. So, I totally agree, Tim.
A really quick point. I think Stephen Lewandowski was the first to talk about how conspiracy theorists and conspiracy theories are self-sealing. Yes. So you... a really good contemporary, very recent example. Does everyone remember the NFL athlete who collapsed on the field instantaneously? There are conspiracy theories about how it was a vaccine, right? Instantaneously. And Hamlin, the athlete, came out and said, no, it wasn't a vaccine. His family came out and said, no, it wasn't a vaccine. The physicians involved said, no, it wasn't a vaccine. And experts around the world said, no, it wasn't a vaccine. And so the way that they dealt with that was Hamlin died on the field, and there's a body double that is pushing the vaccine lie. I'm not kidding. You can get online, you can see this. That is how conspiracy... The mental gymnastics is Olympic level, right? Mm. To maintain their worldview. And I'm sure you see it all the time.
Yeah, this study is, it's not a study, it's an essay that I think was popular a year or 2 years ago. If you contact me after, I can't remember the author's name, but it was a game designer, somebody who designed video games, and he wrote an essay comparing QAnon to a video game. And basically, like, the same system of rewards that exists in a video game exist in QAnon, like in terms of, you know, you finding nuggets that like reinforce your your worldview, and you feel like you get points from that, and it's that notion of like the self-contained world of the conspiracy theory is that makes it so powerful, right? Because it kind of protects it from the intrusion of reality. You know, there's always an explanation that allows you to stay within the game, or that always an explanation that allows you to, like, oh yeah, well, it's obviously a body double. Obviously all the doctors are lying. Well, I mean, you know, there's always another layer that you can add, and you feel good for adding it, right? Because you know, you've like kind of protected your identity that like from these external threats to it.
Do we have a second? I wanted to get back to the question because, and I don't know the research on this, so I don't know if you folks do, but I wonder if it's interesting to me because with the anecdotes of people who've said that they've come out of it, and even in one of the vaccine Q&A calls that we've had, this grandma was so desperate to see her grandkids, but she wasn't vaccinated. And so she started to go down the rabbit hole of why she wouldn't get vaccinated. But of course, the one influence to get vaccinated is because her daughter-in-law won't let her see her grandkids without getting vaccinated. And in another story, a woman was talking about something that happened to her family that sort of pulled her out of it. So I wonder if it's sometimes that personal trigger that helps to pull people out, those people who actually get pulled out of that radicalized rabbit hole per se. I don't know if there's any research on that about it.
I know some anecdote, but research, I don't think so.
I'm not aware of any research either, and it's a great question, because this goes back to, are there more people who are hardcore conspiracy theorists? Because once you become part of that community, I think the research tells us it's very hard to pull you out.
I'm just going to ask a question. I'm sorry. I know this is violating the rules here, but yes, you. Is your sense that it takes kind of a cataclysmic event in the same way, you know, that sometimes when we talk about addiction, somebody has to kind of hit rock bottom before they seek help. Is your intuition as researchers that it takes something like, oh, I got arrested at the Capitol Hill.
That was the example I was going to use.
Yeah, and I'm staring at 10 years in jail. Maybe I have gone wrong somewhere. Does it take some kind of cataclysmic, traumatic event to trigger a rethinking?
So that was the example I was going to use, and you probably know some of the stories where people get arrested for January 6th, but there's stories on either side of that,
yes.
Right? You know, so you have like the people say, oh, now I'm out, and that was, what was I thinking? But then you have the Simone Golds of the world, right? She went to jail, and she just keeps digging, right? She just keeps digging. It's hard to figure out what it is, but, you know, it's a depressing note to end on, because I keep bringing up this, you know, that we're still talking, when you're talking about hardcore, right? We're still talking about a relatively small number, right? The problem is what we can do as a community is stop that small number from having an impact on the broad. And I think that we have more good news on that front, right? With the evidence of what works, what we can do, the impact that we can have. And that is good news. And I think I wonder if you agree with this, even on the margins, like the people that are about to fall down, the people that are you know, pretty into these communities, I still think there's some good news there. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, j'en parlais ce matin. I was talking about this morning, but yeah, I think that the one in between that start to believe they can jump out, and Science Up First, all the research about this information, I think would help to bring them maybe back. But
and that highlights how important it is to do it quickly, get on these things.
Yeah.
Quickly.
Mais si je peux ajouter ce qui est inquiétant sur, entre autres, des gens qui se font arrêter puis qui vont en prison, ce qu'on voit par contre, nous, avec la chaire, entre autres, c'est qu'on a beaucoup de liens justement avec le milieu carcéral, avec les ministères, puis qu'il y a une inquiétude en ce moment dans le milieu carcéral où il y a beaucoup de gens qui, au contraire, se radicalisent, puis c'est des cercles fermés. Je parlais tout à l'heure de la frustration puis de la méfiance envers le gouvernement, le politique, la science. Mais souvent, dans ces milieux-là, il y a cette espèce de frustration-là. Puis c'est vrai que nous, à la chaire, on nous demande souvent de parler parce qu'ils essaient de comprendre le phénomène, parce qu'on voit dans certains milieux carcéraux que c'est le contraire qui se passe. Ces gens-là commencent à adhérer de plus en plus à des thèses conspirationnistes puis à se radicaliser. Ça préoccupe évidemment là, des agents qui doivent vérifier ce qu'on accorde les libertés conditionnelles ou comment les juges doivent réagir dans les cours de justice, parce qu'ils sentent de plus en plus qu'ils sont confrontés finalement à des gens qui n'ont pas de l'air à se déradicaliser après avoir été arrêtés. C'est même le contraire. Ils ont comme un groupe de soutien qui vient les appuyer en cours. Les juges ne savent plus comment gérer ça. Puis dans la prison, ben, on craint, est-ce qu'on peut les libérer parce qu'on voit qu'ils se sont radicalisés dans leurs croyances. Donc vraiment, ça reste quand même cette préoccupation-là du milieu à travers ça.
Well, thank you. It's okay if it's these are challenges, but there are solutions.
It's complicated.
And we're not alone in this. So thank you very much. I will pass the mic to Elias so you can conclude the day. Thank you. Merci.
Quelle journée, hein? Vous inquiétez pas, c'est une très très belle journée. Avant qu'on aille à notre petit 5 à 7 à l'Abreuvoir qui est juste à côté, c'est le moment des remerciements à toutes les personnes qui ont permis cet événement, en fait, qui ont rendu cet événement possible. Déjà, merci à toutes et à toutes. Vous avez participé à d'excellentes discussions et je suis pas mal sûr que c'était des débuts de discussion. Encore une fois, le 5 à 7, ça va vous permettre de les continuer un petit peu. Je suis sûr que vous avez encore plein de choses à partager. Merci également au personnel de la Grande Bibliothèque. Vous avez été incroyables. C'est une belle préparation. Ça nous a permis de faire un bel événement. un grand merci à tous les panélistes qui ont pris leur temps. Merci, malgré en plus leur emploi du temps très très chargé, d'être ici avec nous aujourd'hui et de partager avec nous. On voulait également remercier particulièrement les collègues du Healthflow Institute qui se sont joints à nous aujourd'hui pour présenter leurs recherches sur les effets de la désinformation et également nos amis du Conseil des Académies canadiennes qui nous ont fait part de leurs réflexions sur le fameux rapport Ligne de faille que je vous conseille de voir si vous ne l'avez pas déjà fait. Si vous ne l'avez pas déjà fait d'ailleurs, je vous conseille de nous suivre sur les réseaux sociaux, donc @LaSciencedAbord en français ou ScienceUpFirst in English. On est présent sur Facebook, Twitter, Instagram et même TikTok. Vous pouvez nous suivre sur tous ces réseaux. On fait des activités et on partage beaucoup, beaucoup d'informations. Encore une fois, avant de passer au 5 à 7, je voudrais accueillir ma super boss, la directrice de la science d'abord, Magda Bima, pour nous donner quelques mots.
Like super boss, that sounded really good. thank you, Elias. Everyone, please join me in giving Elias a massive round of applause. Amazing job. Thank you for hosting this fabulous day. So I'm Meg DeBima. I'm the director of Science Up First, and I'm so incredibly happy to be here with you today. And as Elias and I know my colleagues have mentioned during the day, Science Up First is an initiative of the Canadian Association of Science Centres. And since 2020, we have grown into this internationally recognized platform for creating accessible, creative, and timely scientifically backed content. But taking a step back, we couldn't have done any of this without the forward thinking of Senator Kutcher, Tim Caulfield, who really are, not going to call you a grandfather of Science Up First, Tim, but I'm going to call Science Up First your brainchild. So thank you. And of course, the continued success of Science Up First couldn't happen without our amazing team. Many of them you've met today, they are tirelessly committed to bringing you amazing content. Again, accessible, timely, scientifically backed. It really is our mission to give Canadians the right information to make the right choices. So I'm really proud of this team. They're just amazing humans. So two more minutes. I really hope you guys enjoyed yourself. We've really enjoyed having all of you here. This is our very first in-person event. So the support has been tremendous. Thank you so much. Please do continue to engage with us on our social media platforms, as well as through our newsletter. And this is where you can learn about all the new and upcoming events that we're hosting. The next one coming up is for National Kids and Vaccine Day in collaboration with the Child Health Care Canada. And so this will be held virtually on February 23rd. You can get a lot of information and register for the event online, and please do share it with your networks. So this really is kind of the conclusion of our event. I do hope that we can continue all the great conversations that we've started at our networking event. And if you have any issues finding the location, find one of our staff, come join us, and we can all head over there. So merci for this amazing day, and have a great night.